So this panel is Reimagining Cities, What Does City Planning Have to Do with Livability and Climate Change? And really what we're looking at is cities are the ground zero. They're the intersection of where all of our lofty goals around climate, energy, transportation, water, resiliency writ large, where it really meets is at cities. And so we've seen cities do interesting things. We've seen cities falter in this heady responsibility. But what we want to talk about today is how do planning departments and how does the planning job of cities relate to this quest to integrate all of these different strains of sustainability and resiliency? And we have an amazing panel. Now, I am not going to read their bios because if you don't know who they are, you probably shouldn't be here. Okay, I'm kidding. Because Verde Exchange does a great job of providing bios, so we're not going to spend time on that. Mostly you're here to hear them and not me. So what I want to do is actually turn it over to Gail Goldberg to help us frame this. And I'm going to start with this and just say, you know, Gail was the former planning director of the two largest cities in California. She also ran or is currently running ULI here in Los Angeles. And she has the wonderful vantage point of sitting on the Strategic Growth Council. She's in a particularly good space to tell us about what it really means to be a planning director and having to deal with all of these competing issue areas and mandates. So what I want you to address, Gail, is, you know, so much of what we've talked about, energy and transportation and water, comes from state policies, right? And in the area of land use, we've seen AB 32 and SB 375 a few years ago try to do the same for land use planning with, you know, some success, not so much. Now we're talking about, in 2017, incredibly high tension around high density growth. We've seen a lot of concerns about that. And at the same time, cities are being called upon to address issues of disadvantaged communities and how climate affects them. So put that all in the pot. And tell me what you think about how this, what role actually can local planning departments play in doing forward integrated planning, and then wearing your state hat, what is the state doing to help us?
Well, as planning director of the city of Los Angeles, I came over time to love state mandates because sometimes it's the only way to actually do the right thing at the local level. Is to basically say to your constituency, the state made us do it, you know. We, like you, don't love it, but the state made us do it. I think it's really hard for the state to make you do anything. And I want to talk just a little bit about how SB 375, which was the state's attempt to get local jurisdictions to really start thinking about the integration of land use and transportation to help us reduce greenhouse gases. And the fact is that the state can't tell the local folks how to plan, and the local folks are quick to respond to the state anytime they even attempt to do that, you know, land use is a very local thing. So what the state actually does is prompt the sort of regional planning agencies to develop policies that comport with what the state is trying to do. So 375 basically didn't tell the local governments to do anything. It told the local transportation agencies, or SCAG in our region, to begin to integrate their transportation plan with their housing, their regional housing needs assessment, and to come up with what the state identified as a sustainable strategic plan, if you will, for the region. And of course, the state is in hopes that when the board of SCAG adopts that sustainable city or community strategy, that it will be implemented locally because the people who vote on it are your elected officials from the local agencies. And so, of course, that happened here locally. But again, it's very difficult from a local level. You know, we look at that plan. So why would we want to do something consistent with that plan? Well, SCAG will give you planning money if you do something consistent with that plan. So the first thing that almost every land use jurisdiction in our region did was get SCAG money and do a bicycle plan. So now we all have bicycle plans, because the money isn't enough to do a really big plan, but it will do maybe a station area plan or a bike plan. But the state, in order to further incentivize, a couple of years ago decided to put their money where their mouth was. And they actually allocated that 20% of the cap and trade proceeds would go to projects that were consistent with this strategy of good integration of land use, transportation. And by the way, all of those things meet the criteria that a lot of us in cities now call livable communities. It's walkability, it's alternative mobility choices. And so, you know, we do, a lot of us like that. I have to point out that there's still some of us who don't like that. So not everybody wants that model or what they would call a livable community. But at least now there was money available for projects. And so many projects throughout the state that met those criteria were able to get money for affordable housing that were around stations or preserving ag lands. I think that my final sort of assessment of how that went is that it still has not reached the level of creating either the resources or the incentive to do real planning, because planning has become extremely, extremely expensive, particularly in big cities like Los Angeles, and particularly in cities where they haven't done planning in a while. So the money that's been available has been, for the most part, for projects, sort of single projects that meet the criteria. But until we find a way to really finance big city, big plans for general planning, big plans for community plans, and given the complications of the public outreach effort in this environment, I think that's our challenge. So I think we've done a good job of setting the table, but we haven't actually served the food.
Great. Well, thank you for that framing. And in a time of scarce resources, you know, we may all be back, but it takes quite a while for the public sector to feel the impact of an increased economy and growth. So a lot of planning departments are still reeling from the cuts and the downsizing that they went through during the recession, and they lost a lot of really experienced people. So we're also dealing with that. But let's go from the big picture down a little bit smaller, and I want to call on Mike Wu, who's the Dean of the College of Environmental Design at Cal Poly Pomona. I'd like to ask Mike, how do you see these pressures to reduce greenhouse gas emissions, promote transit-oriented communities, and build more housing for working people in particular? How do you see all of those pressures playing out in places like the San Gabriel Valley, where your university is located, or even the Inland Empire? Is there anybody doing it really well in these places outside on the east side?
Well, Cecilia, the areas you mentioned, the San Gabriel Valley and the Inland Empire, used to be seen as bastions of suburbia, but I'm here partly to keep the conversation from being too Los Angeles-centric, and to say that even though I live in the city of Los Angeles, I am a daytime resident 5 days a week of the 909 area code. So real Inland Empire people don't view me as an authentic voice, but I wanted to give you some viewpoint in response to what you're saying. I think the winds of change are definitely blowing. There are a number of things happening that I think are changing the nature of thoughts about the future in both the San Gabriel Valley and the Inland Empire. When I first started as dean at Cal Poly Pomona, it was about 2009, I started to go to meetings of business organizations and real estate groups, and I was amazed to hear that the predominant attitude was all the Inland Empire needed to return to prosperity was just to go back to the same urban sprawl and the dependence on high-wage, low-skill, blue-collar jobs to get back to prosperity. And so we started talking about some alternative visions. And we, our school actually put on a conference called Greener Valleys that suggested that both the San Gabriel Valley and the Inland Empire could think about the future differently, and that if we wanted to attract more high-tech industry, more high-skill workers, if we wanted to incorporate the colleges and universities through the Inland Empire and the San Gabriel Valley into economic development, that meant we need to think about different kinds of land use patterns and different kinds of transportation options than were currently available. So that was back in 2011. Meanwhile, along comes a number of other things: the extension of the Gold Line eastward, the passage of Measure M, changing attitudes about real estate and about the future of what kinds of jobs these areas would have. Supervisor Solis has made a big difference in terms of she wants to build up her hometown, El Monte, and she also has an eye on Pomona, where she went to college, and is looking for ways in which the levers of LA County Metro and city government can help to make some changes happening. So I used to be more of a what you could call a command and control planner. Now I find that I'm much more open to opportunistic approaches to how do you use the tools of city planning to take advantage of the opportunities that are out there. It's really hard to bang your head against the wall in terms of going directly against some economic trend. But if there's political support developing for alternatives to cars, if there is more openness, not necessarily to high degrees of density, but at least to alternatives to the traditional single family home, duplexes, fourplexes, things like that, then I think there are real opportunities to use the tools of city planning to make a difference. And I've heard recently that even in San Bernardino County, where many of the elected officials had been suspicious about the Gold Line extension going eastward to the Ontario Airport, because there was concern from San Bernardino people that this was just a covert way to force San Bernardino taxpayers to pay for a service that would benefit Los Angeles residents, that now, as a result of Measure M passing and realizing that the attitudes of millennials about car ownership is changing, that now apparently there's some talk in San Bernardino County about possibly putting a measure on the ballot in 2018, perhaps, that might enable them to fund part of a transit connection. So I think the winds are changing.
That's great. Well, let's bring it back to LA for a minute. And we have Rusty Hicks here, who's the Executive Secretary Treasurer of the LA County Federation of Labor. And Rusty's been leading the county Fed at a time when the county Fed's been very active in endorsing measures like Measure M, Measure A for parks, and affordable housing generally. Most recently, the county Fed jumped into the issue of density and the lack of affordable housing and the lack of good jobs in Los Angeles and people's distrust of the city's ability to do good planning by putting on the ballot Measure JJJ. We are not going to rehash that today. We're also not going to spend our whole time talking about Measure S. But I am going to ask Rusty, do we really think that ballot box planning is the way to restore public trust in planning? Just full out there. Doesn't integrated planning really require some form of city leadership to actually get it done? And how do we get there?
So I know this is the question that David specifically put me on this panel to answer, which is why he is with us today, right?
And he won't leave.
He will be gone as soon as I answer this question. Certainly interesting. I think it's a question if you have to start with, what's the utility of good planning for everyday folks?
That's right.
Everyday Angelenos. Because those that are not, don't have the benefit to attend a conference like this, really care about just a few simple things. One, it's a good job that can provide for themselves and for their families, a good education for the kids, a transit system that gets them to and from a home that they hopefully can afford. And in an ideal world, we would have city leadership that steps forward and has a transparent, inclusive process that results in a beautiful plan that we all agree with. Well, I think the past week or so has taught us that we do not live in an ideal world. And as a result of that, when you don't see good planning, when you do see a crisis develop in the city, such as this, the issue around homes that people can actually afford, a shortage of housing. You see residents begin to take matters in their own hands in varying and different ways. We're in California, and so the ballot box, running a ballot measure is likely not to go away as a way in which voters take measures into their own hands. I think what we have to think about is what do we as organization or institutional players as part of this, what is our role in ensuring that there is solid leadership in the city that helps move the city forward on this particular area. The first is to support the good things that are happening in the city. So when the mayor, the city council steps forward and funds the update of community plans, we should be active in supporting that. When it comes for money for staffing, when it comes to expedited planning process, we should be supportive of this. And this is certainly a new area for the labor movement. I'm not a planner, so I feel a little outmatched on either side of who I have here. But certainly, 800,000 hardworking folks stepping up and saying, we believe in community plans being updated, I think is an important thing. And then in the case in which it is necessary to move forward with the ballot measure, it's important that we give the city the tools, but not give them the handcuffs at the same time. And so ballot measures become an expression of values that provide some flexibility in places where there needs to be flexibility. Because at the end of the day, when it comes to planning, what is the point of a good plan if community members don't understand it and it doesn't have any applicability to their daily lives? We have a equity and equality conversation going on in this country today. When it comes to planning, while folks are worried about a job and an education and a transit system and a housing, they are in many, while climate change is not top of mind, in many ways, our members are the most impacted by impact of climate change. And so I think we have to think about and view planning, city planning, in a way that's meaningful for everyone.
All right, I'm gonna come back to all of you in a minute. Definitely Rusty, because David hasn't left yet.
He'll be gone in a minute.
So Carrie, you're someone who's covered politics, the environment, and local government generally for some great publications here in Los Angeles. And I want to ask you about the politics part a little bit and where you see the trends. So in Santa Monica, they defeated what was known as the Love Initiative in the last election. That stands for Land Use and Voter Empowerment Initiative in Santa Monica. And for those of you who didn't know the details, very briefly, it would have subjected projects that were more than two stories tall to voter approval before they could be approved. So it went down in Santa Monica. So my question for Carrie is, as somebody who covers the region, do you see that as a signal that folks in Los Angeles actually kind of get the bigger picture, that it's not just a question of no growth versus growth? Or do you think it's really just reflective of what's going on in Santa Monica particularly? That city has a really good culture, civic culture of good planning and open and transparency, and God knows if you watch their planning of their city council meetings, there's lots of community engagement. So what do you think that is? Are we looking at a trend, or is that really just particular to Santa Monica?
I don't know, because the LV initiative was so extreme that I don't know if that was indicative of a sort of blossoming of thinking about livability and density. It was certainly driven, I think, by concern about housing prices and affordability. But it was, I don't know if it necessarily reflects a new thinking. And in fact, when I went back and I looked at some of the language of the campaign on both sides, there was hardly any mention of climate change. When people spoke about, we oppose density because density equals traffic equals air pollution, not that density equals walkability and a livability and reducing greenhouse gas emissions. So I just think there's been a gap in education to the public about why we want livability and why we want to design our cities for this type of lifestyle.
I appreciate it. That's actually a great segue to a question I wanted to ask Mike Wu, as somebody who lived through, as a council member in Los Angeles, the last great slow growth or no growth movement. We're in the middle of one right now. Is it any different is it just really the last gasp of the folks that remember fondly the 1970s? Or is this fundamentally different, the way folks are viewing the issues of density, affordable housing, growth, traffic, air pollution?
Well, Cecilia, I don't know if this is evidence of my growing seniority, but it feels very similar. It doesn't feel that different to me, except that the city is bigger, the population is larger, but also compared to the time when I was on the city council, Los Angeles has gone through a couple more decades of urban evolution. And there are things that have happened in Los Angeles that I think the slow growth movement of the 1980s would have had a hard time imagining. I'm referring to the transformation of downtown LA,
yeah,
and the creation of life in a place after 5 o'clock at night, which barely used to exist earlier, the expansion of the rail system, I think that attitudes towards density have evolved. I wouldn't say that even in downtown Los Angeles that density is a popular concept, but I think that there is more acceptance of alternatives to the traditional single-family home that used to be the stereotype trademark of this city. So I think there's been some evolution, but in many ways, I think the arguments today still feel very similar to me that compared to 20 years ago.
Well, I'm going to use the moderator's prerogative to say, I disagree. I think it's a little different. The city looks different. It feels different. I think you're right about like the different models of living, but the electorate is completely different. And it's been kind of interesting to see that. But I want to get back to the climate issue because we are here at the Verde Exchange. So I guess I want to go back to Gail for a second and talk about the state mandates. You know, I mentioned in the intro that part of what cities are also facing is this mandate to deal with not just greenhouse gas reductions, but looking at the impact of their actions on how that affects disadvantaged communities. And you mentioned, Gail, some funding coming down from the state, but let's be honest, it's a whole lot less than cities had before under redevelopment to do planning and to really try to affect, to change the curve of where investment was going. So if the state wants us to take a look at disadvantaged communities and really look at GHG reduction as a principal motivator of our urban planning, what's the state doing to help us out? Is there anything new going on?
Well, I think the only thing new going on that was a part of last year's budget is a new funding source that the governor put out called the Transformative Climate Communities Program, which is one-time money and probably more like a pilot project of almost $140 million that is meant to go to a couple of projects in an attempt to give more money to not just a project, but give money to a sort of neighborhood level program of projects. And I think that really goes back to the whole sort of planning stuff, because in order to really qualify for that money, you almost had to have planned for it.
Right.
You almost had to have had a comprehensive plan in order for you to qualify for that money. Now, that money, the governor sort of gave direction to the Strategic Growth Council that he wanted half of that money to go to the city of Fresno, which I found really, really interesting, because the city of Fresno was one of the few cities that really had done a lot of comprehensive planning. They had done a new general plan. They had done a new downtown plan. They had done corridor plans. They had projects ready to go. And I'm pretty sure that this whole program would not even exist in the state of California had it not been for the city of Fresno bringing together business interests, community interests, and this great planning effort to create this program that they would qualify for half of the money. Now, the reason the governor laid out that half the money would go to Fresno, and he also indicated that he wanted a quarter of the money, so that's about $35 million to go to Los Angeles. And that was because those two cities represent a very high percentage of disadvantaged communities. I think Fresno has probably the most census tracts that have the top 5% of disadvantaged communities. For those of you who don't know sort of what that is, it's a scoring system from EPA that really scores based on economic and environmental stressors. And so the top 5%, the most census tracts were in Fresno, but the most people in those census tracts was in Los Angeles. And so I think Los Angeles, frankly, is probably scrambling a bit, because while we're good at the project level, we don't have the comprehensive plans that position us well for that kind of money. And so we'll have to come up with it.
Right, I want to get a couple more questions in before we do, like, maybe a couple questions from the audience. So I want to turn it back to Rusty for a second. You talked about your 800,000 members. You talked about how really they uniquely feel probably the hit from climate change more than any other communities. They're also the DACs that Gail's talking about. And a critical element of livability is affordability, right? So we are in a high-priced market here in Los Angeles. It's really difficult to produce housing. You said we got to support cities if they're trying to do the right thing. So last year, Governor Brown made a run at trying to tackle the elephant in the room, CEQA, affordable housing, permit streamlining, all in one bundle, and he was going to put $400 million on the table to induce people to come to an agreement. It didn't happen. Do you see any prospects for a grand bargain this year?
Well, I suspect that Sacramento is going to be pretty busy this year just protecting what California currently has in place with regards to climate change. Look, CEQA is an issue that's been discussed for a long, long time. And generally, it's presented as this false choice. Mm-hmm. You can have good jobs, or you can protect the environment. Or you can have affordable housing, or you can have good jobs. And I think there certainly is a deal to be made. I'm not sure if $400 million from the state level is enough money to incentivize a very serious conversation around this. But I do think there is a conversation to be had. I think people are willing to engage in that dialogue in a serious way, but you can't get a deal at the detriment of one of those choices, that it can't be one or the other. It has to be all of the above.
Okay, I'm gonna let you off the hook on that. Carrie, I'm gonna give you one last question. I assume there'll be a follow-up question. That's okay. So, Carrie, you've been following a lot of what's been going on with Measure M. I know you're writing a lot of articles about that. It passed. You know, it was amazing, the support for Measure M across the board around the region. But you had a couple of sub-regions in L.A. County that actually came out against it. The elected officials came out against it. Those were the South Bay Cog, South Bay area, and the Gateway cities. It was sort of interesting, but their voters voted for it. Do you see the resounding support that voters in those areas had changing the attitudes of those electeds in any way? Or do you see any change even now since November, now that they've seen that actually our voters were on board with that? Anything different about the way they're approaching issues of investment, transportation-oriented planning?
I don't know. Good question. I know that they're trying to get in line for the money. And I think they're going to get a lot of money to do local planning. Part of there was a fair amount of money in the Measure M for local return. So they're going to have money in their pocket to do planning for streets, planning for bike lanes. I mean, and some of this money has some strings attached. So even if they didn't support the Measure M, and a lot of it was because they felt like their projects weren't being addressed in a timely fashion, they were at the bottom of the list, they are going to get money, and they are going to have some cash to do some planning. And whether they want to or not, they might be dragged kicking and streaming into a sort of planning for transit, planning for mobility, and livability.
Okay, we're going to have time. I know folks want to talk about things on this panel. We're going to have time for maybe like one question, and then we're going to let them have a food fight up here. Okay, who's in the back? Yes, sir. What's your name?
I'm Thomas Small, City Council member in Culver City.
Excellent.
So we are having this. We're very lucky in Culver City in that we are having this conversation. And we're trying to leverage regional resources, and we're about to start a visioning and planning process centered around our transit district at the Expo Station, particularly on mobility, because the neighbors in that area were getting out their pitchforks and coming at us about the traffic. So we really want to try to crack that nut and find the right balance for a multimodal mobility solution for Culver City. But as many of us know, we're right at the crossroads of the west side of Los Angeles. As Terry Culver said, all roads lead to Culver City. And in the background, there's the affordable housing in the transit district is bumping up against all the other stuff. What are the things that, as we have a great group of consultants that we've engaged to do this, what are the key things that I need to push them on as we go through this over the next few months to make it work?
Anybody want to take that? I do want to commend your city for voting to approve a measure to pay for stormwater management.
Mm-hmm.
Appreciate your leadership on that. That was tremendous.
Yeah. Yeah, as a planner who has gone through some difficult planning processes in communities, I'm going to throw out there that the biggest challenge is the community outreach and how to create a real dialogue with community, which is not about going out and either telling them what it is you're going to do and getting their reaction, which is bad, or going out and asking them blanketly, what do you want, when there's a box and you know that they can't have all the things they want. Community outreach and real civic dialogue has to do with connecting all of the issues that you talked about. People have to understand the connection between traffic and affordability and jobs, and that is something that's really, it's hard to do, but it's absolutely critical in the beginning of a process. And so I would urge you to find the best consultant you can find who really knows how to do civic dialogue so that you have a chance of coming up with a plan that can build consensus.
Let's give Mike a little bit of time.
Councilman, I think your city has a great opportunity because you have the combination of both increased access to transit as well as healthy demand for development right in that area. But if you don't handle it right, it could become a big mess. In particular, I would say while you consider new development options, be sure you keep control of off-street parking. That is, if you want to encourage people living in the new development to not use their cars and use transit, you've got to limit the amount of off-street parking you're developing. In other words, to make that development transit connection work, you have to use both the carrot and the stick to make it work. So if you require too much off-street parking, it's gonna dilute the effect of making transit accessible.
Okay, I've been told that we have exactly one more minute. Is anybody dying to ask a question? Because I have a last hit I'm gonna ask the panelists. Anybody have a great question? Going, gone. Okay, here's my last hit. We're gonna start with Carrie and work our way down. Okay, what's gonna be the main reason why our region does a better job integrating these issues? Land use, climate, transportation, water, energy. What's going to be the driver to finally get us over the hill in local government? Go for it, Carrie.
I'm going to hope for consumer demand. This is going to be the way people want to live.
That's great. Mike.
I would say the same thing I tell my students, which is follow the money. That is, what's going to make the biggest difference here is the voter approval of Measure M and supporting funding for transit, which makes different patterns of development in different kinds of city life possible.
Okay, Rusty.
I would say it's sort of a willingness to invest long term, whether it's the community plans being updated or measures like Measure M, Triple H, and others.
I think a lot of people think these voter initiatives are the way that we're going to hit the elected officials over the head to make them do the right thing, and I disagree. I think the voter initiative those voter initiatives are going to be the thing that hits the voters and the residents of the city over the head and forces us to engage with the city council to demand better planning.
As the moderator, I say the millennials are going to make the difference. Thank you very much, panelists. Thanks for a great discussion.